If this is based on the sermon is loosely based on the podcast from the Thread series Light and Darkness, and I was really impressed. I thought it was great because often we can get stigmatized to this idea of light and darkness, can we? Mm-hmm. So I've got a little song. I got two songs, two clips that Zan is going to play for me. So see if you can guess the imagery from these two bits of music. Go ahead. So that was, what kind of imagery does that conjure up in you?
Intense.
Darkness, right?
Yeah.
Lisa said, come on, that's for old people. That's yours and my generation.
Yeah.
But I ran this one by Scarlett, and Scarlett said, yeah, she even knows that song. So that type of music. So it's not just for us old farts. Okay, the next one. So that was the theme song for Hope, right? Star Wars, the original episode, was A New Hope. So it conjures up this image of light, something good. I asked Scarlett about that one too, and she said, even before I played the music, she said, well, it's got to have trumpets in it if it's light.
Right.
So I found something with trumpets. But I thought it was so, this podcast was good because the stigma of those terms, light and darkness, are sometimes a little bit heavy.
Yeah.
But we had a great conversation on Thursday night with the guys at my place, and we talked about how, you know, in the creation account, when God created and separated the heavens and the earth, and he separated day from night, he didn't make a distinction that one was good and one was bad. God created and said, it was good.
Yeah.
And so we were talking about the first, and I thought, it's true. When you go to a campfire, and the Frozen Chosen is coming up, so please register if you want to join us for that. But if you go to a campfire at night, there's something special about sitting back and looking up at a dark sky and seeing the stars and seeing the vast array of God's creation overhead, isn't it? It's really cool. And so we can often say, well, light is good, dark is bad. But really, is it? So I want to kind of dive into this morning, because I thought, it's not, dark isn't always that bad. Think about your sleep patterns, and this is interesting. God has created in us a need for sleep. And you know, physiology of the human body is we need darkness for our minds to close down and get the rest that it needs. And during that time of the night's sleep, our body introduces human growth hormones back into the body and recuperates those parts that are weak in our body. I know this specifically because of my illness. Part of my brain no longer produces dopamine. And do you know that dopamine is needed for your energy level? And so when you go to sleep at night, your body shuts down, and that's when your brain produces dopamine, which gives your body energy for the day. And I was listening to the podcast, and this idea of how when we wake up in the morning, and even the light from our alarm clock or the blue light from our phone can jolt us into the energy of waking our body up and getting it ready for the stress and the anxiety of the day. Mm. We need that time at night. We sometimes need darkness.
Yeah.
And so I want to look at this study of light and darkness in a different perspective today. And I'm going to read in Genesis chapter 1. It says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. God said, let there be light. And there was light. God saw the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day and the darkness he called night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. Like I said, the amazing thing is God created it. It didn't say one was bad and one was good.
Right. Yeah.
We often need darkness just as much as we need light. And I, please hear me on this. I'm not saying we need to sin, because that's not what I'm preaching. I'm talking about the physical attributes of light and dark. But I want to show us today, or take a look at the scripture to see how sometimes God can work even in the darkest times of our lives.
Yeah.
Even in spite of sin in our lives. And so this idea of light is especially predominant with the New Testament writer of John. He says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. He was in him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John 3, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but the people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. 1 John chapter 1, this is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. You can see kind of what John was thinking when we spoke about light and darkness, can't you? He's making the big distinction that light is good and darkness is bad. And this is typically what Christians think. When you talk about light and darkness, this is typically what we think, isn't it? Well, you gotta stay in the light, but the darkness, no, that's bad, that's sin. But the amazing thing is, we need to realize our sin in order to understand what grace really is, don't we?
Yeah.
Because if we think, oh, we're all good, we're over here, everything's good over here, and we forget what it was like before, we lose gratitude. Sin being revealed in our lives is really a form of God's grace. He's showing us that we need help.
Yeah.
We can't do it on our own. We're lost. The amazing thing is we need to see sin and how much our sins have been forgiven in order to be drawn into a deeper level of gratitude.
Yeah, come on, Chris.
But the amazing thing is, think about this. He talks about Jesus being the light of the world. Have you ever seen that when you wake up in the morning and you see the sun shining through the clouds? And you see the rays coming down, you see the halo around the sun, behind the clouds, you see the different colors of the rainbow coming down. Isn't that the most amazing picture when you wake up and you feel that warmth of that sun? That image is actually called a glory. And this idea of the light being the glory, or this image of the light and the heat and the warmth that comes down being glory, I think describes what Jesus is really like. Because often when we're in our sin, we're afraid of the light. But we're not afraid of the glory. We're afraid of the spotlight, aren't we? We're afraid that someone's going to point out that little bit of sin that's going on right in your heart. And we want to hide from that. But when you get in the glory of the sunlight and the marvel of this incredible creation, it's not fear, it's warmth, it's beauty, it's tranquility, it's safety, it's security. We talked about it on Friday night, and one of the guys was sharing how when he was a young kid, his babysitter would lock him. Babysitter's brother would show them horror movies, and the babysitter would lock him in the basement and turn all the lights off, and how he felt crippled. He wanted to get out of there, but he felt like he couldn't move because that overwhelming burden and that fear of somewhere unknown. But when the light comes on, you just feel like, and I'm safe. right?
Yeah.
We fear the darkness, but we also fear that spotlight when it's deep in our heart. Matthew chapter 4, verse 12 to 17 says, when Jesus heard that John was put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee, leaving Nazareth, and he went to live in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah, land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land in the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. I think the scripture of Matthew is teaching us that Jesus comes not as a spotlight to point out all our individual sins, but as a great light and warmth to say, I got you.
Yeah.
You may be crippled in the darkness, but I'm here to bring the light and the warmth of grace.
Good point. Yeah.
Paul in Philippians, let's read this one. Do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure. Children of God, without fault, in a warped and crooked generation, then you will shine among them like the stars in the sky. Do everything without grumbling and complaining. That's a hard challenge for some of us, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But when we live like that, we will shine like stars in the sky. The amazing thing is God created the heavens and the earth. He separated light and darkness, and he put the moon and the star and the stars in the sky to brighten our darkest path. And Paul is teaching that we can be the light for people as well. This is so cool. I love this idea. My second point, though, is embracing the darkness. Often, and please don't jump to the conclusion. Chris, what are you talking about?
Yeah, come on, Chris, yeah.
Often Christians, and correct me afterwards if I'm wrong, but often Christians can have the stereotypical view of a Christian as being, they shun the sin. They're judgmental. They're hypocritical, they're judgmental, and they push off the sin and they say, oh, we can't touch that. That's wrong. We have to stay in the light. And it's almost a pious behavior. But think about this. Scripture is a little more nuanced than that. And I talked about this. I asked the guys on Thursday night, because my father, I think I've told a lot of you this, my father was alcoholic. And so I grew up with, my dad was in and out of rehab centers quite a few times. And so I loosely heard, I haven't studied it deeply, but I loosely heard of the 12-step programs for alcoholics. Or addicts, right? There's a 12-step program. And they teach in these programs that in order for someone to make a lasting, deep, profound change in their life, what's the first thing, or what's the thing they need to hit?
Bottom.
Rock bottom. What is that? Rock bottom. Isn't that pit of despair in our heart where we realize how sinful, how empty, how lonely, how afraid we are, really deep down in our heart, and how we need help. And Alcoholics Anonymous will never say to go to God. They talk about the universe or the higher power. As Christians, we realize it's not just addicts, it's not just alcoholics. We need to realize inside of ourselves we are nothing. But God works in spite of that. God will bring us to the part where he breaks us. What does Jesus say? We looked at this a couple weeks ago. He said, better for someone to fall on the stone and be broken than the stone to fall on them and be crushed. When we allow our hearts to be broken at the foot of the cross, when we realize we need Jesus, we need help, we need a Savior, when we realize that our sin has led us down a long, bad path, and we need help, When we realize that, when we get broken before the cross of Jesus Christ, that's when God can really make a lasting change in our lives, isn't it? It's realizing that in us, there is a very, very dark place, and we need the light to shine. We need the warmth of Jesus. We need light. But we also need to understand that darkness plays a role in our lives. This is mind-blowing. It's not, hey, I don't want to go near that person because there's sin there. That's bad. No, God is working in everyone's life. Every one of us is on a spiritual journey towards God Almighty. Every one of us is on a spiritual journey towards God Almighty. Are we going to judge someone at the point in that journey where they are? No, that's our role. Going back to the scripture we looked at earlier, we can be a light, we can be a star, we can be a support, we can be someone who helps instead of the stereotypical, and I don't want to be a part of that. When someone shares their sin or confesses something to you and says, hey, I failed in this area, our response should not be, that's bad. Our response should be, tell me more. Thank you for sharing. Tell me more. Because we are all in the same club. We're sinners who have fallen from grace and we need help. God said that he brought the kingdom about for a very specific purpose. To show the world. Read the Beatitudes. The kingdom is there to show the world that we have family. That we have support. The world tells you there is no support. Pick yourself up by your bootstraps. Dust yourself off. Everything will be okay. You know what? You can do that for only so long. But when you hit that dark, muddy part of your soul, we need help. We need people to be the light for us, to guide us, to lead us. As Stephanie shared, I appreciate Stephanie's communion so much. Jesus was led like a lamb to his slaughter. We need to be led as well towards God. We need people in our lives. People are dying every single day. People are committing suicide. Divorce rate is skyrocketing. There's emptiness. There's loneliness. People are being doxxed. People are being separated from families. You see the stuff that's happening all over the world. But God is saying, you are my light. You can make a difference in this world. Mm-hmm. Do we see that? Or do we say, no, I don't want to be part of that. I don't want to get dirty with that sin. We need to get dirty because we've already been dirty. We want to help. We want to remember how much we've been forgiven. Then when you help someone to be forgiven, you remember how much you were forgiven of.
Right.
Yeah.
It's amazing. God works so powerfully even in dark times. Psalm chapter 23. Even though I walk through the valley, the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. People are walking through the valley that's so dark right now. We've been there. What better way to help someone to navigate that valley than to say, hey, hold my hand, I'll go with you. But true trust happens when we can't see very well, doesn't it? When you're in that crippled spot, stuck in that basement with no lights, you gotta trust that the lights will eventually come on. How about Romans? It says, for in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. And in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit helps himself. The Spirit himself, intercedes for us through wordless groans. Times of uncertainty create in us a sense of security and certainty. I was talking about it with Michael. I honestly believe that faith is not measured in volume. Faith is not measured in volume. You can't say, this is just my conviction, but saying, I have great faith. No, I think we have faith or no faith with every decision we make.
Monkris.
Right.
I remember when I was a Christian, and I remember reading the stories of the Christian martyrs of the first century and getting inspired and thinking, that's me. I want to be like that. I want to stand up and be willing to give my life for God Almighty. Do you know that feeling of, I want to do that? Had I been put in the position that the first century Christians were at that time in my spiritual walk, I don't think I could have did it when I look back now. But I think over time, as I walk through the dark valleys, as I walk through the pain, as I walk through the hurts with myself or with my friends, God has created something in me that allows me to stand up for my faith now more so than I ever did when I first became a Christian. Mm-hmm. God is working in you, giving you the dark times, giving you the challenges, giving you the struggles in your life, so that your faith, which is of greater worth than gold in His eyes, will be made pure and refined like gold. That's what God is doing. He's given us these dark times in our lives, these difficult times. But what are we going to do with that faith? Are we going to shrink back? Are we going to say, no, I don't want to go near that sin because that's wrong? Are we going to say, hey, God has led me through a dark time. Let me help you to our friends and our families. Think about this. If life was just all butterflies and roses and sunshine and rainbows, would we really get to understand the struggle of Jesus' faith? If it was all happy and roses, could we really be that grateful? But when we go through the hard times, when we go through the challenges, do we see God working to remind us, look where I pulled you out of, and look where I'm going to get what I'm going to give you? We need the darkness just as much as we need the light, because God is working in our hearts.
Yeah.
In the dark times, when we fall, isn't it amazing when we come out and say, this is awesome. God is incredible. Look at the glory that He's given me. Look at the sun. Look at the stars. Look at the moon. In all of it, He stood back and said, it is amazing. But think about this. When He stood back after He created you and me, He said, that is very good. So as we go out today, I really want to give us some challenges. Let's not pull back when we see darkness around us. But let us remember that we can be the light. We can shine a little bit of light in there. Not a spotlight to point out someone's failures and someone's downfalls. That never helps anyone. Doesn't help us. It's not going to help our friends and our family. But we can be a beam of light, a beam of hope, a beam of warmth that lifts someone up today, tomorrow, the next day. Matthew chapter 5, I'm going to close with this scripture. It says, you are the salt of the earth, and the salt loses its saltiness. How can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp to put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. You know, this scripture, I think, is an amazing passage of scripture. The difficulty is, sometimes you think, oh, I need to let my light shine. This little light of mine, don't you know that I'm going to let it shine? And we put on this facade like, everything's great. Look at, I'm the light of Jesus. I'm the light of this world. But check your heart. What's going on deep down? Sometimes we can put up a false light, and have stuff going on in our heart. What does He say? If the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? There's a distinction. We have to be the light of the world. We have to be salt of the earth, absolutely. But we need to persevere. We need to make sure we're working on that saltiness. Make sure we're working on that light. It's not like everything's going to be good. Where you are today, I don't know. If you've got stuff going on in your heart, you need to get open with it. We can go to our brothers and sisters. Find someone that you feel comfortable with to say, hey, I need some help here. We should be able to come to our brothers and sisters in the family of believers with all security and with all safety and say, man, I've sinned. I've blown it. You know, we talked about it. James says, confess your sins to one another so that you may be healed. It doesn't say confess your sins to be forgiven, because that happens when we get baptized. All of our sins are forgiven. But confess your sins to one another so that you be healed. There's something special. There's a warm salve that's placed on our soul when we confess our sin. And our brother or our sister says, hey, I appreciate you sharing that with me. What can I do to help? Share with me more. Let me be there to support you. You might be going through a dark time right now. I've been there. I've walked through it. Let me walk with you. Doesn't that give you security in your heart and your soul? God created the heavens and the earth. He sat back and he said, it is good. But God created you as something special. He sat back and he said, it is very good. Amen. Let's have a great Sunday.